is the Thriving Dentist Show with Gary Takas, where we help you develop your ideal dental practice, one that provides personal, professional, and financial satisfaction.
Welcome to another edition of the Thriving Dentist Show. I'm Gary Takas, your show host. I'm very excited to have a friend on the show that I had an opportunity to spend some time with face-to-face recently, and we're going to talk about that in the show. Bethany, how are you?
Hi, Gary. Great. Thanks for having me. I appreciate it.
Hey, let me tell our listeners who we have as a guest. And you may have heard of her. And if not, you're in for a real treat in this show. This is my friend, Dr. Bethany Piziks. And Bethany is going to, our topic today, I couldn't think of a more important topic. We're going to talk about a variety of things today, Bethany, but I want to frame it a little bit for our listeners. We're going to talk about kind of the dirty secret in dentistry, which is stress. You know, we're going to talk about, stress and the byproducts of stress. And most importantly, we're going to talk about how to hopefully reduce stress in your life and help you find greater balance. I could not think of a more important topic, and I could not think of a better guest to help you navigate those challenges when it comes to stress. But can we start, you know, can we knock the top off it right in the beginning, Bethany? And by the way, Bethany, I share a wonderful friend in dentistry, Dr. Bob Frazier. I know Bob, and if you're a listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, you'll recognize that name. He was my guest for the 200th episode of the Thriving Dentist Show, where he talked about applied strategic planning. We'll talk about Bob in a little bit, but Bethy and I share a common friend in Dr. Bob Frazier, but we also share three interests. Bethy, you didn't know that we had three things in common, did you?
I didn't. I'm interested to hear them.
This is unfolding for her, too. Well, the three interests that we have is in no particular order, our passion for our profession. Bethany shares a passion for dentistry. Secondly, horses. We have some family connections to horses. And third, participating in triathlons.
Oh, yeah. I guess I didn't know that.
So we share, I feel like I have a soulmate on this interview. We share three common interests. This is the first time I've shared with our listeners that horses have been part of our family. And you were kind enough yesterday to invite myself and my daughter, Lexi. Lexi's our horsey girl. And you were kind enough to invite us out to your winter digs out here in Cave Creek, Arizona, where
I come. Being from Michigan, it's cold there, so I got to come here this year. I'm so excited.
It also kind of helps display how intelligent Bethany is, because she had a choice. In February, she could be in Michigan or Cave Creek, Arizona. Michigan, Cave Creek, and she chose Cave Creek.
Absolutely.
I got to meet two of your team members. Your four-legged team members. I got to meet Lewiston and Gypsy. Gypsy is a beautiful Palomino quarter horse. Gypsy, if I'm not mistaken, 29 years old.
She's been my I've been had her for 20 years. So she's been my coach and therapist through a lot of things.
Wow. And Lexi got to spend a little bit of time with her yesterday. And wasn't it fun to see Lexi and Gypsy connect? And I think within a matter of seconds, Gypsy was able to figure out how much passion Lexi has for horses, and vice versa.
And then
Lewiston, your younger guy, he's a 9-year-old. And is he a Tennessee?
He's a Rocky Mountain Gated Horse.
Rocky Mountain Gated Horse. I think of Tennessee, but Rocky Mountain Gated Horse, yes.
Yeah, he's my athlete, my endurance horse, and I've had horses all my life. So, that's part of my coaching practice is that we partner with the horses.
So our listeners, we're going to weave a tapestry for you in this Thriving Dentist Show. We're going to talk about dentistry. We're going to talk about horses, and we're going to talk about helping you find balance. And believe it or not, all three of them are connected. Imagine that. We're going to connect the dots. And I think this may be one of the most interesting Thriving Dentist shows you're ever going to hear, because Bethany is doing some very, very, very cool things to help dentists and their team members reduce stress in their lives and help them find greater balance. Bethany, I know your backstory, but I'd love you to share it with our listeners. Would you take a few minutes and share your backstory with our listeners, if you would?
Sure. I graduated from University of Michigan Dental School in 1994, and 3 years later, I worked as an associate for a couple of years, and then I started my own practice from scratch, which means I had a lot of equipment debt and two employees, and I had two charts in the drawer, and of course, one of them was my mother. So I don't know if that counts as a patient or not.
But. Well, your mother certainly counts. However, I think we can say with two charts in those file cabinets, with one of them being your mother, you were really starting from scratch, weren't you?
Yeah, totally. Going out on a limb. I was advised not to do it. It's not the way people start practices now. They buy them. And I said, well, I'm not everybody else, and I don't follow the rules very well, I guess.
You're a contrarian. That's another thing we have in common, Bethany. I am also, if the world's going left, I like to turn right.
let's see what's over here. So I started it from zero and was very successful, actually. Within 5 years, I had about 900 active patients. I had a hygienist and an assistant in the front desk. So we were a small office, but we were doing very well.
That's very successful, considering a cold start to build up that size patient base in a competitive area. You know, you're in a town that is competitive, and also in a very insurance-based area where you chose to, again, buck the tide. I think there's a pattern here, Bethany. You chose to buck the tide. Be non-participating. And I'm sure many people told you you couldn't do that, by the way.
Oh, yeah, we were non-par. We went non-par with Delta and everyone. We were non-par in Cadillac, Michigan, which is an industrial town, lots of manufacturing. We make Four Winds boats, lots of manufacturing for the military, things like that. So a lot of teachers, the schools were all Delta. So anyway, it was a school of hard knocks, I will tell you that. I never do anything halfway. So
I think a lot of our listeners, listeners can identify with that. I think a part of being a dentist is that you tend to be all in, don't you?
Yeah, it's kind of all or nothing, I guess, you know, especially if you're owning your own practice. So then on top of that, after 5 years, we outgrew our little basement space. We had a little 900-square foot place, and it was tiny. So I had a vision, and I didn't know I was using vision, but this is Dr. Bob's applied strategic planning model, that I didn't know the name of the process, but I had a vision for a new building, and I had a picture of it up in my office. I looked at it every day, and of course didn't have the money to do it, and it didn't matter to me. I was still going to do it somehow, someday.
You're going to figure it out.
And I was going to figure it out, and long story short, I did. I bought the land, and then eventually broke ground. Anyway, it was a beautiful big brick building, and we moved in 5 years after we opened, and all of a sudden, I have over $1 million debt from the building. I have all this new equipment debt, and I feel this. It's like it's crushing down on me. All of a sudden, I don't go to work because I want to or because I enjoy it. It's because I have to. And I think there's so many dentists who can relate to that, your listeners out there who, you know, even brand new out of school, you have how much school debt now. You know, you could buy a heck of a house with the school debt that they come out with nowadays. And it's this immediate step into a profession, and you're already under all this pressure. But for me, it was causing me, you know, physical problems. I wasn't sleeping at night. I'd wake up in the middle of the night, just, you know, what am I going to do? How am I going to do this? And it was a dark place. I wanted to just drive away and not look back. It was a lot of stress. And that's when I met Dr. Bob. So what he did was inspire me to help others to get out of that dark place, because he helped me. I coached with him. I'm still coaching with him. 15 years later, we still have a coaching relationship, because I think everyone needs a coach. And that's my passion now, is to help other dentists live better lives, relieve the stress of the daily work, and do it in a way unique in all of dentistry by partnering with horses. So that's the short story of my background.
Bethany, thank you for your honesty and your candor in sharing your story with our listeners. I know that I imagine that every one of our listeners in some way, shape, or form will be able to identify with your story. And thank you for being honest and candid and recognizing the stress and the frustrations that you feel.
I think it's an issue that, like you said in the beginning, that it's not addressed. We tiptoe around it. It's the elephant in the room. There's a lot of courses on practice management, office protocol, scheduling for production, clinical skills, team communication. But there's no, what about the stress? What about the heart and the spirit of the leader themselves? And how does all this anxiety and pressure affect them? It affected me greatly, and I know I'm not alone in that.
No.
I've talked to a lot of people.
And think about it, Bethany, that if you have a successful practice as measured financially, you know, you have a successful practice, you've got this wonderful facility, you love taking care of your patients, but you're carrying around the stress that results in cardiovascular plaque and you end up having a heart attack. What success is that?
It's not. It's a big problem. And the number one way that dentists are dying today is early stress-induced cardiovascular disease. So that's a big problem. I know many dentists who've had in their 50s having heart surgery and bypass.
Can we recognize, and again, this is the, you know, that 500-pound pink elephant in the room, or 5,000-pound pink elephant in the room. Let's recognize that dentistry is demanding. And I'm going to use that word. It is demanding. Bethany, I think you
can.
So
demanding.
Yeah. I think I'm, I don't know that I can even find the right adjectives to describe how demanding it is.
It's intense. It's intense. It's unforgiving sometimes. It's demanding. It's just, it's like, well, the best adjective that I used to use is I'm going to the gauntlet today. And I know that's not a good way to think of your work, but sometimes it's felt that way.
It's honest. It's honest, Bethany. And that's what I want to, you know, one of the things I love about you and your perspective is that, you're okay sharing your fallibility and, you know, your struggles.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think there's, you know, I have a colleague, in fact, I've had him on the show a number of times, Dr. David Hornbrook. I'll bet that you recognize David's name, Bethany, but he's a brilliant cosmetic dentist in San Diego. And one of the things I love about David, and David and I have been friends for many, many, many years. I'll bring him back on the show again coming up. But one of the things I love about David is that when he's lecturing, and he's a brilliant, brilliant, brilliant clinician, he's not shy about showing his mistakes. And, you know, he'll show his failures. And, of course, he shows many successful cases, but he'll show his failures with the goal of helping others.
Right.
It's like, hey, if he made this mistake and he can save it from someone else for making the same mistake, what wonderful, you know, what a wonderful learning opportunity those mistakes become. And Bethany, in a way, you're doing the very same thing. You're sharing your story with our listeners. Let's fast forward, if we would. By the way, I'm going to put Dr. Frazier's interview, my 200th show. I'm going to put a link in the show notes so that if you're listening to this and you haven't heard that show about applied strategic planning, I want you to click on that and listen to that, because powerful. It changed your life, Bethany. And Bob is an amazing guy. He's been a mentor of mine for over 30 years. And if you haven't listened to that, I'm going to put it in the show notes and encourage you to listen to that, because all of this will make more sense when you've had a chance to hear that as well. But let's fast forward and talk about the horse element of this. And so I know that as you worked through your applied strategic planning and talked about, you know, if your life was perfect, what would it be? It involved working with dentists and their team members and working with horses to help find balance. So you founded your company, Braveheart Equine Coaching. What's the mission of Braveheart?
Yeah, the mission of Braveheart is our primary focus is to help dentists and their teams to learn new ways to relieve the stress of dentistry and all of its side effects. And when I say side effects, I'm talking about the physical, the mental and emotional, and, you know, the daily effects of stress. So we're unique in all of dentistry in how we help our clients do this, in that we partner with horses to do that. It's a profound process, and it's a new way to manage and relieve the stresses of everyday practice.
Help our listeners, for our listeners that are not involved in the horse world, help them understand how horses can help with this process.
Absolutely. Horses are, well, they're my partners in this process. They're not props or mirrors. They're actually active participants in this process. And let me tell you just a little bit about the horses and why they're so good at this and so sensitive to what's going on. And what I do is give the horses a voice, because their essential gift to humanity, I truly believe, is healing of the human heart and spirit. And, you know, they've plowed our fields, they've carried us on their backs, they've fought our wars, and they don't mind doing that, but they're really here to help us to heal. And it's a brand new field. It's only been being really noticed and studied for the last about 35, 40 years. So horses, you know, you go back thousands of years, they are prey animals, which means they're on the bottom of the food chain. There are animals out there who want to eat them. And in order to survive, they've had to develop this extremely sensitive sixth sense of feeling what's going on. Is there a predator in the bush before I can see it, smell it, or hear it? And so they have this sense of what's going on. Is it okay? Should I run? Should I stay? Is it safe? So over time, they've developed this sense.
So it's keenly, it's very, very finely developed, very keenly developed, correct?
Their survival has depended on it. So, and they haven't lost any of that over time. That even though they're domesticated and they're in a fence and they get fed three times a day and they always have water, they're still always watching for the predators. And you know that if you know anything about horses, you know, if they see a squirrel in the tree, that they jump if they don't know what it is and they run. And the invisible squirrel syndrome.
Right.
But, so translate that into the coaching arena. You know, you bring a horse into a coaching arena and they see what's really going on inside of us. They can sense it. It's like an electromagnetic energy. They can sense it because they've had to over thousands of years. So they sense incongruence. If you have a smile on your face and you go to the barn and you act like everything's okay and you're deathly afraid of maybe your kid is in the hospital and they might have problems. If you go out there with a smile on your face, the horse does not want to be around that incongruence. So they'll remove themselves from the situation, or they'll act afraid, or they'll show you what they know is going on inside of you. You can't lie to a horse. They're completely, you know, they're equidetectors. We call them equidetectors.
You can't fake it.
You can't fake it. And my friend Sarah Sherman, she's a colleague and friend of mine who does this work with kids. Her famous line is that they see our armor and they pierce it with love and compassion. So they open up space, a sacred space for us to really see ourselves in truth, sometimes for the first time. So let me give you an example of this, because this is kind of like trying to tell somebody who doesn't have taste buds what a strawberry tastes like. This is
great.
This
analogy.
Is really, yeah, it's really hard to put into words because it's an experience. So just, you know that as I tell the story, it's more of a, you have to experience it. But we were talking earlier about the stresses of the profession, and I know that one of the biggest stresses of the profession, it was for me anyway, and the clients that I work with, is that dentists tend to be perfectionists. They tend to micromanage.
No.
They tend to.
No.
It's just a slight tendency, you know. We have big hearts. We mean, and we want to do things well. Things are important to us. So it's the nature of the business, you know. And so it's hard for us to delegate and trust our team.
Bethany, I'll make a bold statement here. I believe that virtually every one of our listeners fits that description to a T. And I'm, in a way, I'm using that term perfectionist as a compliment. Because it can be,
yeah, me too.
You know, it can be a very good quality, but in the same way, it can be a bit of a damaging quality as well.
It can go both ways, and a lot of times the stress that we experience in the office is because of it. Because, you know, when you're micromanaging your team, anyways, I had a dentist come in with his team for an annual retreat, so there's a few different ways I work with clients. I do individual coaching over the phone. It doesn't always involve horses. Horses are an adjunct to this, which mm-hmm. is amazing. I mean, they help so much. We also do individual team retreats, like an annual team retreat, very impactful, unique way to bring your team together. And we do retreats for only dentists. So this was a team retreat. Let me set the stage a little bit. We're in a indoor horse arena about the size of a football field. It's about 100 yards long. And it's a covered arena with a sand floor. And inside the arena at one end is a 60-foot diameter round pen. It's just a metal pen that the horse is in. And the participants and I sit outside the round pen in a circle, and we do a lot of work outside the pen, but that's just setting it how it looks. So this particular team and dentist came because they were, well, the dentist was completely stressed out. He couldn't put his finger on what was wrong, but the team had low morale. He said, I can't get my team to do anything. I tell them what to do all the time, and they don't do it. Our treatment acceptance is down. It's not working out well. We need to do something different. He was searching, you know. So he came to me with that chief complaint. I call it the chief complaint. So what I did is I set up an experience with the horse, and here's how it went. I wanted to set up something that would show him that his team is competent. He can trust them. Trust is a huge issue. I mean, let me go back, you know, to family of origin issues, which we deal with also, but he was having a lot of problems delegating and trusting. So I told the team, this is your task. The dentist sat this out the first time. The team had to decide who's going to sit on the horse. One person had to sit on the horse with their eyes closed or blindfolded. And the rest of the team had to get this horse through an obstacle course safely with that person with their eyes closed. So imagine what that would be like. Mm-hmm. So I let them just do it how they were going to. I didn't give them any instruction. And it was a disaster. I mean, they went into their normal dysfunctional roles. The front desk person went into the bossy role. The hygienist, you know, the hygienist went into the know-it-all role. The assistant stood back and crossed her arms. And who's going to sit on that horse? I'm not sitting on that horse, you know.
You've just described a number of meetings that I've experienced as a coach. But
I know.
Thank you.
Oh, it's amazing. I mean, how you do anything is pretty much how you do everything. So this is how it did. All the dysfunction came out. And I told them, the horse is part of your team. This horse is not a prop. This horse is part of your team. You have to treat him as such. So, you know, they got anxious. Everybody started, you know, it got very tense and the horse started to get anxious. So that's when I call it. I say, okay, let's debrief and get off the horse. How did you decide who was going to sit on the horse? Did you figure out who was the most comfortable? You know, not really the bossy one, just said, you get on the horse. You know, they didn't have any, there was no logic. So anyways, we did it again. Ended up doing it like four times. But the dentist was watching his team learn. He got to see they were competent. He got to see how the horse started to, when they started working together and communicating and really working as a team, that horse was part of that team, and the horse acted this, you know, as part of the team. He was calm. They walked through the obstacles, and the person had a blindfold, and it worked out great. So then, that was only half of it. Then we put the dentist on the horse with a blindfold, and he had to trust his team to lead him through that obstacle course. And again, it was a disaster at first. To actually experience this is so impactful. You know, to actually sit and trust your team, not being able to see when you're on this horse.
At the beginning of this exercise with the dentist on the horse, there had to be major hesitancy on his part. You know, think, oh my gosh.
I didn't think he was going to do it at first.
Right.
I mean, this is a half day. This took a half day. So this is a really short story for how this worked out. But here's what happened. At the end, they finally, he trusted. He finally let go. I mean, there were tears. He was physically shaking and crying, and he finally let go. And when they got through the obstacle course, the feeling of camaraderie and success, and the horse was calm, and it was so perfect. Like, you know, in the memory, then we debriefed. So what happened is they take this back to the office, and the next time the dentist is saying, so-and-so, did you order the right gloves? I think we're going to get low on gloves. She can go, why don't you saddle up and put your blindfold on? You know, and they kind of laugh about it.
It reminds
him.
A new vocabulary.
And the thing is, this is experiential. He's not sitting at a conference room at a Holiday Inn with white tablecloths and candy dishes, listening to someone talk about trust your team, delegate and trust. He's experiencing it bodily, somatically. He's aware. He's present in the moment, because horses demand that we are present in the moment in order to even be in our space. Sometimes the horse will step on your foot to get you back to the present moment. They'll say, there, now you're back. You're in the present moment, you know?
You know, you raise a great point, Bethany. I'll use an analogy. I know you've taken a massive amount of continuing education yourself, you know, in your career. And it's kind of like,
I was a junkie.
Right. It's like the difference between going to a didactic lecture is one option. Secondly, going to an over-the-shoulder course where you see the instructor. For example, Dr. Hornbrook gives over-the-shoulder courses where you can watch him doing a 10-unit upper anterior porcelain veneer case. Or a third option is where you actually bring a patient and do that type of treatment. And I think we would agree that the interaction is so much of a higher learning experience than a didactic lecture experience. Would you agree?
Absolutely. It is imperative in order to retain it. So when this is called the equine gestalt coaching method that I use. Now, the word gestalt, it's another word for wholeness. And there's three components to gestalt. Number one, it's being present. It's being in contact with the horse, the environment, the coach, the team. And it's such an unusual state to be in as a dentist, because you're working on a patient, you got two hygienists waiting, you're behind in room three, and you got the front desk wanting to ask you a question. So how present are we in that moment, or any moment? Most of us are just pulled in all these directions. So to get into the arena and to drop all that into the sacred space of the arena and to be present with your team, the horse, the coach, is invaluable. The second component to gestalt is somatics of the body. What is your body feeling? What is your body telling you? We're in our heads all the time, and we're not in our bodies. We're not feeling our heart, our feelings. What is it telling us? And the horses want us to be in our hearts. That's when they connect with us. If we're in our heads, they're not with us. They're in our hearts. That's what I was showing you yesterday with your daughter, Lexi, when I was having her think math, and then I had her change to how she felt walking around the arena, and the horses reacted differently.
Yeah, when she was in her, you asked her to do some math problems in her head and walk around the arena, and Gypsy had no interest in her. She was disinterested.
She's in her head.
And then as soon as she started thinking about a happy moment in her life and started thinking with her heart, immediately Gypsy came up to her and literally pressed her heart against Lexi's heart. It was amazing to see. It was wonderful to see.
They're very interested in that.
So you can't fake it to the horse. You can't say, yes, I'm present. And in fact, not be present. What a great exercise for any dentist though, because I think you're right. I think imagine, you know, some of our listeners will be working out of two or three operatories at the same time. Well, let's just talk about today in my own practice. It's a Monday. Paul's a solo dentist on a Monday. We have three hygienists on Monday. And so it's not unlikely that he might have to get up three times during the hour to do three hygiene checks. And then he typically is working out of two rooms, you know, with an assistant. We've got it scheduled in such a way, so it's hopefully a finely tuned kind of orchestra there where he only has to be in one place at once. But typically, because of assistant time versus doctor time, but it can be hard to be present. In fact, if that continues over a pattern, a dentist can develop a pattern of behavior that really is thinking about the next thing, not necessarily thinking about the present moment right there.
And it spills into the personal life. And there's nothing wrong with, you have to almost be that way when you're practicing. You have to be able to do three things at once. But like you said, exactly, it spills over. And then when do we let ourselves go? When do we let our minds go into the free flow space of just being present? And that's when the creative and inspiring ideas pop in. That's when you have those moments of bliss, when you lose track of time. We all allow ourselves that gift. And being in the arena with the horses, that is part of the gift of their presence and being in a different environment.
Bethany, can I take a little detour for just a second and share a story with you?
Yeah.
So I have a mentor, Dr. Omer Reed, and our listeners will have heard me talk about him in the past.
Omer Reed.
Isn't Omer fantastic? Anyway, I want to share this story with our listeners because it relates exactly to what you're talking about. I started working with Omer in 1980, so my goodness, 36 years ago, and he was a mentor of mine then and is still a mentor today. And in the early 80s, I used to go into his practice here in Phoenix and just hang out. I would just sit in the reception room and I would observe, and this is where I got to learn from a master. And at the time, you know, Omer had two associate doctors in his practice, had five hygienists, so imagine the activity, three doctors, five hygienists. A beautiful facility, but rather large.
Makes my stomach hurt just thinking about it.
And Omer was an absolute master with all this activity going on. When he would walk into the hygiene room and do a hygiene exam, it was as if that patient was the only one in the entire building. He was so good at being centered and being focused on them. And the patients would feel his presence, you know, in terms of being present right there. And how that translated to his success was that patients placed a high degree of trust and confidence in him because they knew he genuinely cared about them. And he worked
at
it. He might only spend 2 minutes or 3 minutes in a hygiene exam, but the patient felt like that they were the center of his attention, that he had no distractions, and it was masterful. And to this day, is still masterful.
That's like a guru Zen mastery right there. That's amazing.
Yeah.
That's awesome.
Hey, let's come back to the horses for just a minute, if you don't mind. I don't imagine you'd have a problem talking about horses, right?
No.
Let's come back to the horses. I can think of so many questions around that. And I know many of our listeners are thinking about this. Do they need to have horse experience? Well, what if they're afraid of horses? And, you know, what if one time a horse stepped on their foot? You know, talk about that.
Right.
Diffuse that for them, if you would.
Yeah. Well, this work is not about horsemanship. And this work is about the client. And the horses and I are coach partners. So they don't need to have any experience with horses, and there's usually no riding. I talked about the one experience with the dentist sitting on the horse, but there's someone on each side making sure that they're safe. If you're afraid of horses, usually there's been an experience in the past where someone got on a horse and the horse took off and they fell off and got hurt as a kid. and have never been on a horse again, and, you know, whatever the story is. If you're afraid of horses, in my mind, all the more reason to work with them, because every single day of our professional careers, we are asking people to face their greatest fear of being in a dental chair and allowing us to do our work, because we know there's a gift behind that fear, the gift of a healthy mouth, the gift of a healthy body, being able to smile.
A gorgeous smile.
And we ask, we ask our patients to work through that fear. So first of all, it helps us as dentists understand what our patients are going through as they come in and trust us to their care. Second of all, there's a gift behind that fear. The horses have a message, and the only way to hear the message is to come and find out what it is. It's different for everyone. The horses have individual messages for everyone. So if you let fear prevent you from getting that gift, then you'll never know what it is. So that's the answer to that one.
What a great answer.
You know, I find that when I face my greatest fears is when I get my greatest gifts and greatest inspired ahas.
You know, and I think it's important for us to recognize that while us in dentistry typically don't harbor fears of the dentist, obviously, because this is what we do, but so many although you'd be surprised how many dentists I've met, you know, that have shared with me that ironically, they have some concerns about someone working on their mouth, you know, so I mm-hmm. that does come up. But it's important for us to remember that many patients experience a disabling fear, you know, of going to the dentist. And we have to recognize how much courage it takes for many people to get into your office in the first place. And I can see where this exercise would be very helpful in helping get better command of that whole concern.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Absolutely.
Hey, let me put you on the spot for just a minute, Bethany. Do you mind if I put you on the spot?
Sure. That's what I'm here for, Gary.
Yeah. So, I'm getting excited about, you know, thinking about this process and thinking about the many different variables, your story about the team that came out and went from a dysfunctional team to one that was functioning at a very different level. Can you share with our listeners some results that you see as a byproduct of your work?
Yeah, well, some of the possible results are, it's a wide array of positive outcomes, all the way from, you know, discovering you've been using an ineffective leadership style to all the way to uncovering and healing from family of origin issues that are causing problems in the office today. And a lot of common office challenges arise from both of these things. So say someone's discovering they're using an ineffective leadership style. Let me give you an example of that. Another quick story about how that was resolved in the horse arena. I had a associate dentist. She was a young woman in her 30s, and she was an associate, so she wasn't the owner. So here's a common challenge as an associate. You're supposed to be the dentist and the leader, but you don't sign the paychecks. So who's listening to you, and do they listen to you? And it's frustrating because if they don't listen, you know, and you're, how do you navigate that as a leader? You know, so as a young leader, she wasn't getting the results from her team that she was asking for. And so that was her chief complaint. She was in a group of dentists in an all-dentist retreat. Her team was not present. So what we did was we put her in the 60-foot round pen with a quarter horse named QT, and he's black and white paint. And before we put her in, we showed her how to round pen a horse. Like when I say round pen a horse, the horse will run around and around and around. And then I showed her how to change directions, make the horse change directions, speed up, slow down, all these commands. You do it non-verbally and verbally. And we showed her the body language and how to do that. So she got to try. She got into the round pen. and she picked up a little stick, you know, and I said, okay, have QT walk. And she says, with her shoulders slumped and looking at the ground, she looked up at him and said, walk. Do you think QT walked?
I know this one. not so much.
You know, not feeling it. No, absolutely not. He did not move.
And who's telling, who's telling me to do what? No, thank you.
Yeah, you want walk? Are you kidding me? So the horse, that's how she was leading her team. You know, she wasn't speaking with authority because she didn't feel like she had authority. She wasn't giving direct, clear commands or
she was ambiguous about her authority. And so that was, you know, remember 93% of communication is nonverbal. I didn't make up that statistic. That comes from studying communication. 93% of communication is nonverbal.
Yeah.
And when your body language doesn't match your words, it's incongruent. And the horse knows that.
They know that. So we worked with her. Again, this took a long time, an hour or two. And, you know, she got angry. She begged, she pleaded, she yelled, and the horse was like, oh, no.
Yeah, I'm thinking the begging didn't work.
No.
Yeah, not so much.
No, it doesn't work.
Anger probably not so much. Yeah.
Anger not so much either. You know, he just looked at her. So finally, we got her to stand up straight, you know, talk from her gut, aim her energy from her solar plexus right at the horse's rear end, and with confidence, take a step forward and say, walk. You know, there's a huge difference in that. And she finally got that horse to move in any speed she wanted, switching directions. So think about, so you asked the results, the possible results. This is another example where she goes back to the office and she remembers how her body felt when she was being clear, concise, and specific and focusing on what she wanted. And that horse responded accordingly. The team does the same thing. So she was able to remember that feeling and remember when she started to slump or say, walk instead of walk, mm-hmm. You know, it is a huge difference. So huge results, impactful, long lasting. You don't forget that. This is nothing that you're not going to go back in a week later, forget this, because it's somatically ingrained. The emotions are retrained. You're new pathways in the brain to respond to the environment. And it's not something that you forget.
Yeah, this is so cool. I'm just thinking, my mind is thinking about all the cool applications for this. Very cool.
Oh, it's endless. It's endless. There's so many creative ways to partner with horses and have them show us how we're acting in the world and they open up the space for us to get it.
Love it. You know, you know, I know your background. I know your credentials. You know, this isn't something that you just, you know, read a magazine article from and thought would be cool to do. You actually have very detailed training in this. Could you talk a little bit about the training that you have that has allowed you to do the work that you do? Because it's very impressive and you have a remarkable combination of training. Would you share with our listeners some of that training?
Sure. Yes. I did not just make this up. This is in searching for a career that would combine what I loved to do the most, which was coaching others to their best life and being with horses. I came upon a woman who was in this program called Touched by a Horse, and Melissa Pierce is the owner and founder of this program. She's a founder from in the 80s of the horse human healing movement. She's up with John Lyons and Buck Brannaman, and probably a lot of people may have heard of these.
These are the Gordon these are like the Dr. Gordon Christensens of the horse world.
Yeah.
Is that a good
Gordon
way to put it?
The
Frank Spears,
yeah,
the
Black GR, is it GR Black or what? The originals. So anyway, she was a psychotherapist and she has created, it's called the Equine Gestalt Coaching Method, and she has a 2-year program that's very intensive. It includes 10 core classes, which are 4 days each of hands-on clinical experience with doing this coaching method. And it's as many or more clinical hours as a master's degree actually in therapy.
Wow.
So we don't call ourselves therapists. We are coaches, mm-hmm. but the program is, it's a certification program through Melissa Pierce's program called Touched by a Horse.
Very cool.
I was certified and I graduated last year. So it's been a great road.
You know, Bethany, I want to take a minute and say thanks to you. I love your honesty at recognizing what is a major issue in our profession, which is the stress that we all face. And I love your candor and your humility in addressing that. And I know our listeners will want to be in touch with you. I'll put all of this in the show notes. So if you're driving, don't take your hands off the wheel. I'll put this in the show notes. But Bethany, would you be kind enough to share your website address with our listeners?
Absolutely. The website is braveheartequinecoaching.com, all one word. And also, if you go to my website, I have the top 5 tips for dentists on relieving stress on a daily basis, and you can download it. It's a PDF, and you just put your email in, and you'll get this free gift.
I'll put a link for that specific. You have it's top 5 tips for reducing stress for dentists. I will put that in the show notes so they can just click on that and receive that. That would be fabulous. And also,
absolutely.
You've been kind enough to offer our listeners an opportunity to kind of chat with you about your coaching.
Yes, absolutely. I have a free exploratory coaching session you can sign up for also on the website. You can put a link for that also. I think I sent you that link.
Yes.
And would love to take the time to talk to anyone who's interested in this work and wants to hear more about it, has any questions. We do a free call, so sign up for that. I'm also doing on April 1st a webinar on stress for dentists and reducing stress. It's called No Fooling Around, Reduce Stress, or Don't Let Stress Kill You, something like that.
On April Fool's Day. Perfect.
April Fool's Day. No fooling around. Reduce stress before it kills you. So
that's
going to be a webinar too. So we do a lot of things, you know, trying to get the word out that there is help for this and you don't have to suffer alone and make life better.
I know our listeners would like to reach out with you by email as well. Would you be kind enough to provide your email address?
Yes, it's Bethany, my first name, Bethany@BraveheartEquineCoaching.com.
I'll go ahead and put that in the show notes, and I want to extend an invitation to our listeners. Please reach out to Bethany. She's a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful spirit, and just send her an email and say thanks. I hope, by the way, we crash your server, Bethany. I mean that in a playful way. I hope we don't create too much work for your IT guy, but please reach out to Bethany.
Thank you. I'd love to hear from you all. Let me know what you think of this.
If you happen to be in dentistry and you're a horsey person, just reach out to Bethany and connect. And I'm going to really put you on the spot. Are you ready?
Okay. I'm ready.
And I want to clarify, we did not talk about this ahead of time. So for our listeners' benefit. So if you're hearing this, it made it through the editing process and Bethany gave us the right answer. If she didn't give the right answer, then I'll edit it out. But if you're hearing this, it made the cut. Bethany, would you be willing to put together a workshop for Thriving Dentist Show listeners? And we could do that one of two ways. We could either come up to Michigan, probably more like in the summertime, we could come up to Michigan. Or when you're out here, I know you spend a couple months out here every year in the winter, usually in February and March, right?
Oh, absolutely. I would love to do that. You mean a retreat?
Like a retreat specifically for Thriving Dentist Show listeners. And we'd come out together. I'd be happy to participate with you and add some content, you know, from the business practice management side, but would love the majority of it to be focused on your work. And we could either do that in Michigan in the summer or we could do that in Arizona in the winter. How's that sound?
Oh, absolutely. I have a facility in Michigan in the summer, and then I have one in Colorado I can use in the fall, in Virginia, and here.
Oh.
So we can decide the best place for the best weather at the time of year. And
perfect.
I would love to do that for you. The other thing is, the one thing I didn't mention, I do about 2 retreats a year, and there's one in Virginia in November. So it's under my upcoming event on my website. Check it out if you have any interest. This is so helpful, this work, and I'm so passionate about bringing this gift to our profession that I just want, I want people to know about it. So thank you so much.
Well, thank you. And if you're interested in us coordinating something for the Thriving Dentist Show listeners, shoot me an email. My email is Gary@Takacs, T-A-K-A-C-S, learningcenter.com. Shoot me an email and let's just call it equine in the subject line. Just put equine coaching workshop, equine coaching workshop. And let me know your interest, and I'll work with Bethany to coordinate that. And we'll put some. It'd be fun for us to get together as a community in a small group and combine the wonderful work that you do. But Bethany, thank you so much for your passion for our profession and for helping colleagues deal with that 5,000-pound elephant in the room of stress.
Yeah, thank you.
And it's making a difference.
Thank you for helping get the word out.
Oh, my pleasure.
Thank you so much.
My pleasure. As a listener to the Thriving Dentist Show, let me take a minute and say thanks to you. We sure appreciate you. There's three things you can do to help us. One is you can share the show with a colleague. You likely have a colleague or a friend that's never heard of a podcast. If you'd be kind enough to take a minute and share them, explain to your colleague what a podcast is and direct them to the Thriving Dentist Show, we'd love to have even more listeners. Secondly, you can write us a review on iTunes. If you jump on iTunes, there's a spot to write a review. If you write us a review, that helps us be able to have more dentists find us via iTunes. And the third thing that you can do is you can subscribe. If you don't already subscribe, it's free. Hit the subscribe button on iTunes or on Google Play, whatever your listening channel of choice is. Hit the subscribe button. That means that every Wednesday when we upload a new show, you'll get the new show uploaded to your listening device. It's free, and I'll make sure that you'll never, by doing so, you'll make sure that you never miss an episode of the Thriving Dentist Show. On that basis, let me simply say thank you and let you know I look forward to connecting with you on the next Thriving Dentist Show.
When you cry, be sure to dry your eyes, 'cause better days are sure to come. And when you smile, be sure to smile wide, and don't let them know that they have won. And when you walk, walk with pride, don't show the hurt inside, because the pain will soon be gone. When you dream, dream big, as big as the ocean blue. When you dream, it might come true. When you dream, dream big.